Sundibon, am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. Very good afternoon to all of you. I welcome all the participants here present, and I also heartily welcome our today's speaker, Dr. Shubhashish Dhal, and all other respected faculty members of Government General Degree College, as well as other dignitaries present over here. The blockchain and cryptocurrency is the topic of our today's webinar, and it is jointly organized by the IQAC and Department of Computer Science, Government General Degree College, Singur. In recent years, there is a lot of buzz of blockchain. Many have described this act as most disruptive technology of the decade. Especially the financial markets could be the most affected ones. The technology is being adapted into many verticals like healthcare, medicines, insurance, mass properties, automobiles, and even governments. However, so far, the most successful implementation of the blockchain is the Bitcoin, a peer-to-peer electronic cash systems, which is incidentally it's also the first implementation of the blockchain technology. Today, we have got our eminent speaker, Dr. Shubhashish Dhal, who will enlighten us on this topic of blockchain and the cryptocurrency. Now, I'd like to call the coordinator of IQAC, Government General Degree College, Singur, Dr. Choitali Chaudhary. She's also the head of the Department of History, Government General Degree College, Singur. I heartily welcome Dr. Chaudhary, and I request him to deliver his welcome speech.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of IQAC, I welcome you all in this national webinar organized by Department of Computer Science, Government General Degree College, Singur. Today, our speaker is Dr. Shubhashish Dhal from IIT Guwahati. Thank you, sir, for gracing this occasion to enlighten us with your knowledge about this topic. He will be giving a speech on blockchain and cryptocurrency. I would like to thank the Computer Science Department for their endeavor for constantly giving lessons about a plethora of interesting topics for all these days. Thank you once again, Sundipan, Shomit, and Anupam for organizing such seminars. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chaudhary. Dr. Chaudhary has always encouraged us to organize such a webinar. Also, she always support us in the various ways. Now, we are moved to the next session of our seminar. Before I call on the stage Dr. Shubhashish Dhal, I want to introduce Dr. Dhal. Dr. Shubhashish Dhal is assistant professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, IIT Guwahati. He obtained his PhD from IIT Kharagpur. His research interest includes security and privacy in IoT, blockchain, deep learning based classification. He has several publications in national and international conference as well as journals. I heartily welcome Dr. Dhal, and I like to call Dr. Dhal to deliver his lecture. Dr. Dhal, please.
Yeah, so am I visible? I guess.
Yes, you are visible.
Okay, so am I audible also, right?
Yes.
Okay, so I would like to thanks for inviting me, and also I would like to thanks Dr. Chakraborty, Dr. Chaudhary, and especially Dr. Basu for inviting me for this webinar. So Dr. Vasu actually is my student in Azadus College way back long, right? So when he asked me to give a talk, so I thought I can give a talk on consensus algorithm on blockchain. So I thought that consensus algorithm is one such topic which is more relevant for this theme. So I'm starting that presentation. So So I think my screen is visible. Yes,
Yes,
yes.
sir. Your screen is
Thank
visible.
you, thank you. So as I've said that I will actually give the talk on consensus in blockchain. So it is an important topic in blockchain. So I will cover these topics. So first I will introduce what is blockchain is, and then what is consensus is, then consensus a little bit or broad aspect of consensus in blockchain. Then I will discuss three basic algorithms, although basic, but they are popular algorithms which are used in not only cryptocurrency but also many other blockchain-based application. And finally, I will conclude with some remarks. So these are the topics that I will cover in today. So what is blockchain? So there are many different definition of blockchain, but this definition is more relevant to this topic. So according to this definition, it is a decentralized computation and information sharing platform that enables multiple authoritative domains who do not trust each other to cooperate, coordinate, and collaborate in a rational decision-making process. So as you can see, the color words, they are basically the keywords for this definition. So first keyword is decentralized. So decentralized means that there is no centralized authority which will control the entire system. So the system will be controlled by many party, and they do not have trust among themselves. Although there are multiple party involved in controlling the entire system, but they do not have trust among themselves. So these multiple parties who do not have trust among themselves, they will cooperatively and collaboratively coordinate to take any rational decision. So here you can clearly see that some decision will be taken, and that decision will be taken collaboratively, cooperatively by multiple parties who do not trust among themselves. So let us see what is centralized system so that the definition will be more clear. So in a centralized system, there is a central party who is responsible for entire decision-making process. So there is a single coordinator, and that coordinator is basically responsible for any kind of decision. So he or she does not need to discuss with anybody else in order to take any decision. That's why the decision-making process is very fast, because he do not need to consult with anybody else. So this is a centralized system. So it is, of course, very fast and easy to take decision because only one person is taking decision. You do not need to consult with anybody else. So of course there's no possibility of any conflict. But the biggest problem is single point of failure. Single point of failure problem means if that single party, which is the central authority, if that authority is somehow failed, then the problem is that the entire system will be failed at that point of time. Okay? For a very simple example, which we have usually experienced, that in a banking system, there is a server. If the server is, say, broken, then any kind of transaction is stopped, at that particular time, right? So if I have to transaction at particular time and the server of that bank is broken down, or you can say down, so in that time I cannot actually perform my transaction. Okay, nobody me, not only me, but also anybody, other customers, also can, no customer of that bank cannot perform any kind of transaction. So this is a problem called single point of failure, and this is a very vital problem in a centralized system. So on the other hand, there is a decentralized system where instead of a single party, there are multiple party who take decision or who basically involved in controlling the entire system. So it is so you can clearly see that any kind of decision, if they have to take, they have to coordinate among themselves. So they have to consult among themselves. That's why this consultation will take a lot of time, because there is some network among themselves, and using that network they have to consult among themselves so that one proper decision will be taken, right? So decision making process will be very slow in this case. So this is a little bit this is one problem, but the biggest advantage is there is no single point failure problem, right? So you can see there are three party who are involved in this entire system in order to take any kind of decision. So whenever a decision has to take, these three party, they consult among themselves and take the decision, right? And if somebody fails at some particular time, there are other persons who can take control of the system. So if some party, one or more party fails, then the entire system will not be broken down. So maybe some part of the system will hamper, but the entire system will not be broken down, right? So this is the biggest advantage of the decentralized system. But of course, there is a it is a little bit slower than the centralized system. So blockchain is a kind of decentralized approach, right? Here, the system is maintained in a decentralized manner. There is no central authority will take any decision or will control the entire system, but multiple party are involved, and all are collaboratively can take decision, right? So whatever the data they have, all the data are maintained locally by the participants, right? Here you can see there are four participants, and everyone are maintaining their local data, and all the local data are consistent among themselves, right? Consistent among themselves means that whatever the data is having with this party, the same data is having with this party, right? So there is no such central storage where from where they will access, but the data are stored locally to the party, to them, right? But the system is designed in such a way that although the records or all the data are maintained locally, the system will ensure that all the data or records are consistent among themselves, right? So this is the concept of blockchain. So now I can abstractly show that how exactly blockchain works, right? So whenever somebody has to perform any task, that user basically send his or her request to the blockchain, and so you can see this user wants to execute one particular task. So that user basically send his request to this blockchain network, and in this blockchain network there are multiple party. They see the request and they take decision whether the request or the task has to be executed or not, okay, whether that task is eligible for execution or not. So they individually take the decision, and after individually after taking the decision, they consult among themselves in order to reach to a proper decision. Okay. For example, this guy is taking one decision, say A1. This guy is taking one decision, say A2. And this guy is taking one decision, say A3. And this guy is taking a decision, A4, right? But whenever they will consult among themselves, there some algorithm will run among themselves, and that algorithm will ensure that ultimately they will come up with single decision, right? And according to that decision, the task will be executed. After execution of the task, a block will be created, right? And that block will be verified by all the party. And after successful verification of that block, the block will be added into the blockchain, right? So blockchain is nothing but a chain of blocks where they are connected or they are linked cryptographically, right? So there may be first block, which has been created at the very initial stage. There is some information, and then another block will be created. And though, so the second block will contain the hash value of the first block, and then another block will be created, that is third block. Third block will contain the hash value of the second block, and then fourth block will be created, and fourth block will keep the hash value of the third block, and so on and on, right? So in this way, if the informations will be kept in the chain of block, it is very difficult for anybody to tamper the information. Because if somebody wants to tamper the information in block one, he has to tamper the hash value which is kept in block two. Then he has to tamper block two also, right? Consequently, he has to tamper block three and block four and so on and on, right? So suppose there are 1,000 blocks which has been created, and somebody wants to tamper block one. So if somebody wants to tamper block one, he has to tamper 1,000 blocks, right? So which is very, very difficult task cryptographically. Cryptographically, it is very, very difficult task to tamper all these blocks, right? So in this way, the informations are very secure in this network. So that is why in most of the distributed system, blockchain concept is used. Okay, so this is the basic idea of blockchain. Now let us see what is consensus. So as you have seen, that there are multiple parties who are involved in the decision-making process, and everybody are keeping the records locally. And whenever some request will come, they will consult among themselves and ultimately come up with some decision, right? So they have to reach to an agreement, and in order to reach to an agreement, they have to consult among themselves. So an algorithm or agreement should be there, which will be achieved distributively, right? So this agreement can be achieved distributively, but there is a possibility that some of the party may be faulty, right? Some of the party may be faulty or may be malicious, right? For example, here you can see that there are four party available, right? Among these four party, one of them may be faulty or malicious. So even if some party is malicious or faulty, still they should reach to a proper or correct decision or correct agreement, right? So this problem is first formulated by these guys, so Stockpiece and Lamport. So you can actually follow these references in order to know more about this consensus. So this is basically formal definition of consensus algorithm, or rather you can say that this is basically the abstract view of distributed consensus. So you can see that we should have a consensus algorithm in order to reach to an agreement to take proper decision or correct decision, right? So we should design some algorithm which will help us to achieve that that task, right? So whenever somebody wants to design an algorithm, he has to basically see these three property so that the algorithm should satisfy these three property. Okay, so there are n nodes, each have an input value. Some nodes are assumed as faulty or malicious. So your algorithm will assume all these things, and your algorithm should have these three property, right? So according to the first property, the protocol will terminate, and all honest nodes will agree on the same value, right? So there are n number of nodes. Among these n number of nodes, there may be some faulty or malicious node, but the protocol will terminate with same value after some finite amount of time, right? So this is called termination. Now, according to the second property, if two honest parties decide on V and W respectively, then of course V will be equal to W. What does it mean? It means there are two parties, say one party is A, another party is B. A is taking decision, say V, and B is taking decision, say W. Okay. So if both of them are honest, of course V will be equal to W after termination of the algorithm, right? So agreement should be proper, right? And according to the third property, there should be some validity, right? So agreed value must have been proposed by some honest node, right? So whatever decision has to be taken, or whatever decision will be taken, that should be proposed by honest node, right? Maybe it is quite possible that some faulty node is there, or maybe some malicious node is there, and that node is proposing some value, and and your algorithm is taking that decision. So if that is the case, then your algorithm is actually not correct, right? So in order to see whether some algorithm is correct or not, we have to check whether these three properties are getting satisfied or not, right? I just wanted to say that if somebody have any question, please stop me so that I can answer, or I can clear your doubt, right? So please do not hesitate to stop me if you have any doubt, so that I can move forward clearing your doubt.
Sir, sorry to interrupt you. Actually, we put it the question answer session at the end of this talk.
Okay. Fine. So, then I will see that how. Basically, consensus. Basically, I will abstractly show how consensus is achieved in a general blockchain network. Right. So, at any given time, all nodes have a sequence of blocks of transaction they have reached consensus on. Each node has a set of outstanding transactions it's heard about. So, let us see that there are multiple party. Okay. And all the party are consensus or reached consensus for some transaction, right? So you can see there are three parties. This is one party. It is having some transactions. This is having some transaction. This party also have some transactions, right? Now, many transactions has reached to a consensus, and those transactions has already been added into the blockchain. But some transactions are pending, right? So this guy is having these transactions which are pending, which yet to add into the blockchain. Similarly, this guy also have some transaction which is pending. This transaction has to be added into the blockchain, and similarly for this guy also, right? So at some particular time, this is the current situation, and this is basically the blockchain. Okay, where all the confirmed transaction has already been added, right? And this blockchain is maintained locally by all the parties, right? So the same copy of this blockchain is kept with this guy, the same copy of this blockchain will be kept with this guy and this guy, right? And some pending transaction also will be kept with them, which has to be confirmed among themselves, right? So what will happen? So all this guy will create a block. So this guy has created this block, which is having the pending transaction. Similarly, this guy has created one block, which is having pending transaction, and also this guy is having created this block, right? So after creation of these new blocks, they will propose their own block in the network, right? So everyone will propose their block, right? And a consensus algorithm will execute, and eventually the algorithm will accept one of the proposed block, right? So here you can see three blocks has been proposed, and the algorithm will accept the one block among these three blocks, right? And that block will be added, and the corresponding transactions will be confirmed, right? So even if there is a single block proposed, that also can be accepted and will be added into the blockchain, right? But your algorithm should satisfy three property, that is termination, validity, and another one is agreement, right? All these three properties should be satisfied by the algorithm, so that a valid block will be accepted. So here you can see this block has been accepted, and this block will be added into the blockchain, right? So this block has been added into the blockchain. It means this block has been proposed by some honest party, okay, non-faulty party, and algorithm has satisfied the termination property, and the decision, whatever has been taken by, I mean, the block, what the block which has been added by any party are basically the same block, right? Okay, so up to this point of time, we come to know that we need to design a consensus algorithm which will satisfy three property. But in order to design a consensus algorithm, we have to face some challenges, right? So there is a peer-to-peer or point-to-point network. So this blockchain network is basically kind of point-to-point network or peer-to-peer network. So point-to-point network means there is direct connection from one party to another party, right? So there is a direct link between any two party in the network. So that kind of network is called point-to-point network. And on the other hand, peer-to-peer network means there is a communication from one party to another party, but may not be a direct communication, but via some other link. But of course, there should have communication between any two parties in the network, right? So there may be point-to-point network or peer-to-peer network. So in this network, we have to face challenge whenever the algorithm will run. Right. So what are the challenges that we have to handle? First thing, node may crash, right? So sometime one node may become faulty. Okay. Suppose node is or computer, your computer is working correctly, but at certain time, somehow the computer becomes crashed, right? So there can be crash in the network. Some node may be malicious, so we have to take care of these things. And there is imperfection in the network, right? So in this world, anything is not perfect. Of course, in the network also, we cannot expect that it is totally perfect. So there will be imperfection in the network. The imperfection in terms of not all pairs of nodes are connected. We are telling that there is a point-to-point network and peer-to-peer network. That means there is some direct or indirect link between any two parties, but in reality it may not be possible, right? May not be the fact that all the pairs of nodes are connected. Okay, so there can be faulty in the network. Okay, not network, maybe may become faulty at some point of time, and there may be some latency in delivery, right? So these are the challenges which you have to handle when you are designing your consensus algorithm, right? So whenever you are designing a consensus or agreement algorithm, you have to take care of all these challenges. So many algorithms can be proposed, but which algorithm is better, or which algorithm we should use, or whether a proposed algorithm should be accepted or not, in order to evaluate, we need to use you can say parameters using which we can evaluate those algorithms, right? So first parameter say that what is the resiliency of the algorithm. So according to this parameter, it basically say that what is the fraction of the total number of node, if that fraction is malicious or faulty, then the algorithm will still work correctly, right? So suppose T out of N nodes are malicious, right? If that is the case, then the T out of N number of nodes are faulty or malicious, in that case also the algorithm will work correctly. So okay, so that is called resiliency. Okay, and this value should be maximized, right? If this value is greater, of course that algorithm is very good, right? So if we compare two algorithms, say algorithm 1 and algorithm 2, so suppose for algorithm 1 the fraction is t1 by n, and for algorithm 2 the fraction is t2 by n, where t1 is greater than t2, then we can say that algorithm 1 is of course much better than algorithm 2, right? Because its resiliency is better than algorithm 2, right? Second one is running time. So what is the maximum time an algorithm will take in order to reach to a proper decision? That also has to be checked, right, before accepting an algorithm or before comparing an algorithm. So we have to check what is the running time of the algorithm in order to evaluate the algorithm, right? Finally, we have to check what is the communication complexity. So during consensus protocol, during when consensus protocol will execute, many messages has to be communicated among multiple parties involved in the decision making process. So what is the communication complexity? That means how many messages we have to communicate in order to execute the consensus protocol. So that also we have to check. So of course we have to minimize the communication complexity, we have to minimize the running time, and of course we have to maximize the resiliency. So here you can see there are three parameters using which we have to evaluate the algorithm. For a good algorithm, we have to maximize resiliency, we have to minimize running time, and we have to minimize communication complexity. So in this way we can judge a consensus protocol for its quality. So I will discuss three basic or very popular consensus algorithm, which are very popular, and some of them are used in real life. In Bitcoin, you can say Bitcoin is very popular. Some of these algorithms are used in Bitcoin and some other cryptocurrency. Right. Yeah. In the literature, or in the state of the art, or you can say in the research community, already many consensus algorithms are available. So these are the different consensus algorithms which are available in the literature. So let us see some of them. So first, we discuss a very basic algorithm, which is called Byzantine Agreement. Okay, so before going to discuss the algorithm, let us define what is Byzantine node. Byzantine node is, you can say, one kind of faulty node, right, or malicious node. So if I define Byzantine node, it is a node which can have arbitrary behavior. That means anything imaginable operation it will perform, right? So this node is called Byzantine node. So there is some history. I'm not going to that history of the keyword Byzantine. Okay. So in one word, I can say that Byzantine node means it has some arbitrary behavior. Arbitrary behavior like it will not send any message at all, right? So one node has to forward some message, but it is not sending any message at all. So if this is the behavior of a node, then that node is a Byzantine node or faulty node, or you can say malicious node, right? There is another property that it is sending different and wrong messages to different neighbors, right? So a node will send one message to one neighbor and is sending another message to another neighbor, right? So it is saying that I will go to your home to one neighbor, or I will go to I will go to Kolkata in one neighbor, and somebody and to other neighbor it is saying that I will go to some other place, say Delhi, right? So if this is the case, then this behavior also can be considered as a Byzantine behavior, right? Or so this node is called Byzantine node. And third kind of malicious behavior they can do is lying about the input value. So they are receiving some input value, say x, and they are distributing the that value by saying it is y, right? So it is receiving say 10, but it is distributing by saying it is 30 or 100, right? It is not saying the exact value. Okay, so a Byzantine node basically behave in this manner. So but honest node is supposed or expected that honest node will not behave in these manners, right? So this in Byzantine agreement protocol, the main objective is we have to find out the consensus in a system with Byzantine node. So this is called Byzantine agreement. So there are multiple nodes. Among these nodes, there may be multiple nodes which are Byzantine node. Even if there is some Byzantine node, the Byzantine agreement will reach to a proper or correct consensus. So this is the main objective of the algorithm, right? So an algorithm is called a pre-resilient if it still works correctly with a Byzantine node, right? So so there are n number of nodes. Among these n number of nodes, f number of nodes are Byzantine node. So if f number of nodes are Byzantine node and still the algorithm works correctly, then it is called a pre-resilient algorithm, right? F resilient means it can resilient maximum F number of faulty or Byzantine node, right? So let us see very simple algorithm. So we consider that there is single node which is faulty or Byzantine. So this is the algorithm which will be executed by one node, one honest node. So this is the code for node U. We are assuming that the input value is X. So there will be three rounds. In first round, it will send a tuple with its own ID and the input value X, and it will be sent to all other nodes. And also it will receive the tuple from all the other nodes involved in the network, right? So it will send one tuple, and it also will receive the tuple which is sent by other nodes involved in the communication, right? Store all received tuple in a set, say SU. So SU is the set where all the tuple will be kept by node U. Then in round two, this set which has been created at round one that will be circulated among themselves, right? So similarly, all the nodes also will receive the set circulated by others. So the node U will send one set which has been created at round one, and also it will receive set from all the other nodes which has been created at round one. So it will generate one set called T, and it will add the set SU in T if at least two sets seen if there are at least two sets SV seen in that T, right? Or in SU, right? So you can see there is SU. SU consists of some tuple, right? And SU will be accepted if SU consists of two similar tuple, right? So T will be, T is generated in the way such that it consists of the tip, it consists of the tuple if the tuple is there at least twice in set SU in the set SU or SV, right? So in this way, this T will be created, and suppose tuple T V, tuple V Y has been added into T, and suppose so this is that set set of all the tuple which has been added by node U, and smallest value Y will be selected by this node, right? As the final result. So I think so this value will be decided among themselves, right? So this algorithm will be much clearer if I show some example. Probably it is not clear here. It will be clear if I show some example, right? So let us see the example. Then I guess it will be very, very clear, right? So we have four nodes here. So N1, N2, N3, and N4. So this is node 1, node 2, node 3, node 4. And it is the input value of this node is x1, input value of this node is x2, input value of this node is x3, and input value of this node is x4 or x5. So why it is x4 or x5? Because we are assuming that this is a Byzantine node, right? So you can see here we have four nodes, but one node is Byzantine node, but remaining three nodes are honest node, right? So in round one, every node will circulate this tuple, right? So this node will circulate its tuple 1x1. So this node will circulate tuple 2x2. This node will circulate tuple 3x3. And this node will circulate tuple 4x4 or 4x5, right? So you can see that node N1 has received a tuple from all the other nodes. So it has received the tuple from this tuple from here. It has received this tuple from here. And it has received this tuple from here, right? You can see. So N4 has circulated or sent 4x4 to node N1, right? Similarly, node N2 is receiving tuple from other nodes. So this node has received from node N1. This node has received from node N3, and this node has received from node N4, right? So similarly, this node also will receive some tuple, right? Here you can see that N4 is sending X4 to node N1 and N2, but it is sending X5 to node N3. So clearly you can see the behavior of node 4 is Byzantine behavior, because it is sending one message to one guy, and it's sending another message to another guy, right? And it is receiving this message from the other nodes, right? So after receiving this tuple, so these are basically SU, or you can say SV. If you remember, in the algorithm, we have the set SU and SV. So after generating SU by every node, okay, they will circulate the sets to every other nodes, right? So here you can see that this node will circulate this set to everybody else. This node will circulate this set to everybody else. This node will circulate this set to everybody else, right? And at the same round, every node will collect the sets from all the other nodes, right? So here you can see that this node is collecting this set from this node, this set from this node, and this set from this node, right? Okay, so similarly, this also will collect the sets from other nodes, and this also will collect the set from other nodes. These also will collect the set from other nodes, right? Now, after collection, what they will do? They will, according to their previously decided policy, they will select the minimum value among themselves, right? So you can see that that x1. So of course, now question is, which minimum value, which values they will consider in order to decide which is the minimum value, right? They will consider x1, right? So this node will consider x1. Why this will consider x1? Because it is occurring minimum twice, right? So here you can see it is occurring minimum twice, right? That is why it will consider x1 for decision, for final decision, right? Then it will consider x2. Okay, why it will consider x2? Because it is also occurring minimum twice. Okay, that is why it will consider for decision, taking decision. It will consider x3 because you can see that x3 is also occurring twice. Okay, but it will not consider x4 because x4 is occurring only once, right? Similarly, x5 is also occurring only once. Okay, so in a similar fashion, you can see that this also will consider only x1, x2, and x3. This also will consider x1, x2, and x3. Any honest node are not considering either x4 or x5 because they are occurring only once, right? That is why they will not consider either x4 or x5. Okay, so after generate considerable sets, I mean considerable values, then they come up with one single value. So based on their previous policy, they will decide with the small value, right? Smallest value. Okay, so suppose the smallest value is x1. So x1 will be decided by this node. So here also you can see that x1 only will be decided, right? Because you can see among x1, x2, x3, x1 is the smallest value. And x1, here also x1 is the smallest value. So we assume that x1 is the smallest value among these x1, x2, x3, right? So here you can see that all the honest node, that is n1, n2, n3, they are reaching to an agreement or consensus to a single value, okay, which is proposed by a honest node, that is n1. Okay, they are not reaching to a value which is proposed by some dishonest node, right? Here you can see x4 will not be accepted in any way. Even if the value of that x4 is less than x1, that will not be accepted by node n1, that will not be accepted by node n2, and that will not be accepted by n3, because they already discarded the value x4 or x5, right? So clearly you can see that the consensus algorithm, the algorithm reaching to a consensus, even if there are some party, in this case the number of parties only one, so even if there are some party which are faulty or malicious, still they can reach to a common decision here, which is x1, right? Okay, so these are basically theoretical things. I will not discuss in details. From this example, I am not formally proving these lemmas or theorems, but I am informally using that example. I can say that if n greater than equals to 4 and a equals to 1, all correct nodes have the same set T, right? You can see that there are four parties and f is equals to 1, right? And they have the same set T. So here for this case, it is the T is this. For this node, the T is this. And for this node, the T is this, right? So you can see that all the honest node will have the same set T, right? So they will have same set T if the value of n is greater than equals to 4 and the value of f is equals to 1. That means there are only one node which is faulty or malicious. According to this theorem, Byzantine algorithm for f equals to 1 reaches Byzantine agreement if n is greater than equals to 4. That means according to this theorem, it says that if there are n number of parties which is greater than equal 4 and f is equals to 1, then of course they will reach to an Byzantine agreement, right? They will reach to a correct consensus or agreement, right? According to this theorem, three nodes cannot reach Byzantine agreement with all same validity if one node among them is Byzantine, right? So from this from the example what I gave, according to that example, you can see that the value of n is greater or equals to 4. Okay, so in that case the agreement can be reached, but if the value is less than 4, okay, it is not possible to reach to consensus, right? Okay, so let us see why it is not possible, right? So for in order to see that, let us see the board work. Okay, so I guess the board is visible. Sandeep, can you confirm whether board is visible? Sandeepan?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Visible.
Yeah. Okay. Fine. Thank you. So suppose we have a three party. So node. So basically we can say there is one general, and under this general there are two lieutenant works under this general, right? So lieutenant L1 and lieutenant L2, right? So it is quite possible that general is malicious or dishonest, but these two lieutenants are honest, right? So it will, since general is malicious or faulty, it will send one message to one of its lieutenant. So it is sending the message as retreat, okay, and it is sending message attack to this lieutenant, right? So clearly you can see that general is malicious or faulty, right? So L1 is honest. So it will forward the message which has been received by it. So it will forward the message retreat. Similarly, L2 is also honest. So it will forward the message attack, right? Now you consider this node, okay? So this is the honest node. It is receiving retreat message from general, but attack message from the lieutenant, another lieutenant, right? So it is this lieutenant will be confused that what is the correct decision. Is it retreat or it is attack? He cannot actually take decision whether he should retreat or he should attack, right? Okay. So here you can see it is not possible to take a proper decision for this guy whenever there are three party, and among these three party, one of them is malicious, right? So similarly, I can draw another figure where one lieutenant is malicious or faulty, right? So L1, L2, right? So general, in this case, general is honest, so it will send the message retreat, and it will send the same message retreat to this lieutenant also, but you can see, suppose this guy is faulty, right? So this guy has a faulty, right? So since this guy is faulty, so it will forward the wrong message, right? Whatever the input it is receiving, it will forward the message, it will forward some other message, right? So instead of forwarding retreat message, it will forward the message, say it attack, right? But this guy is honest, so it will forward the same message what it has got, it has received, right? So it will send retreat. So if you consider this node, it is receiving retreat message from general, and it is receiving attack message from lieutenant. But there is no way to know which message is correct. Okay, because this lieutenant do not know whether general is faulty or this lieutenant is faulty, right? So it cannot decide among retreat and attack, right? So from here you can see that if there are three party, and among these three party there are one malicious or faulty node, then it is not possible to take a decision, right? So in this way you can say that this theorem is correct, right? So we can generalize this fact in theorem 3, right? So for this theorem is applicable only for three nodes, right? But that can be generalized using this theorem, right? So using this theorem, we can say that a network with n nodes cannot reach Byzantine agreement with tip greater than equals to n by 3, right? Suppose there are n number of nodes and number of faulty nodes is greater than equals to n by 3, in that case it is not possible to reach to a Byzantine agreement, right? So I am generalizing this fact. So suppose there are n number of nodes, and I am dividing the n number of nodes in three groups, right? So every group will have n by 3 number of nodes, right? Now I am dividing the groups in such a way that one group will consist of all the faulty nodes, right? One group, there will be minimum one group which will consist of all the faulty nodes, right? So all the nodes will be divided into three groups. So group 1, so group 2, and group 3. You can see that if f is greater or equals to n by 3, so it has n by 3 number of nodes, it has n by 3 number of nodes, it has also n by 3 number of nodes, right? So if f is greater or equals to n by 3, then of course I can prepare a group such that one group is full of all the malicious nodes, right? So if the value of f is n equals to, if the value of f is equals to n by 3, then you can see that maybe one group is full of all the malicious node, and these groups may have one or more faulty nodes, but not all the nodes are faulty, right? Now you can see there are three groups, group 1, group 2, group 3. Now this is totally faulty group. This is totally faulty group. This is some honest nodes are there in this group. Some honest nodes are there in this group, right? Okay. Now if the similar kind of thing I apply here, I can say that the decision cannot be taken, right? So I can say that if there are n number of nodes and f is greater than equals to n by 3, then it is not possible to take correct or proper decision, right? So in this way, we can say that this theorem is correct, right? So the conclusion is that if there is a network with n nodes, then we cannot reach any Byzantine agreement if the number of faulty nodes is greater than equals to n by 3, according to this algorithm, what we have seen, right? So this is our very simple algorithm, which we have seen. Next, let us see another algorithm, that is practical Byzantine fault tolerance algorithm, right? So this is also one popular algorithm. So this algorithm is applied in an asynchronous environment So asynchronous environment means it will allow, or it will basically allow the out of order messages, right? So if some nodes are not synchronous among themselves, still it will basically tolerate those nodes, right? It will handle Byzantine failure and it will provide the security, right? So let us see the system model. So there are the state machine. So there is a machine. So each single machine is replicated multiple times, right? So there will be a machine, and that machine will have some defined function, and that defined function is replicated multiple times, and that will be replicated 3f plus 1 number of times, right? So total number of machines in the network is 3f plus 1, where f is the number of malicious or faulty nodes, right? So f is the number of, or maximum number of, faulty or malicious nodes. And there can be succession of configurations which can be known as views, right? So in one view there will be one boss, and rest of the nodes will be so in one view there will be a primary node, and rest of the nodes will act like secondary nodes, right? So we have one primary node in a view, and other nodes will act as backup nodes. So this algorithm also will work in three phase. In phase one, primary node will prepare this message. So this message consists of this information. I am not going into the details of this information. So this pre-prepared message will be created by the primary node, and this will be broadcasted to all other nodes. In second phase, all other nodes will receive the pre-prepared message and will verify the pre-prepared message for its correctness. Okay, and if they will see that the message is correct, then they will accept that message and will create another message called pre-prepared message. Right. So how they will check the verify the pre-prepared message? They will verify using the signature of the primary node, right? So if the verification is successful, then this replicated node will generate the pre-prepared message and will broadcast the pre-prepared message to every other nodes. So all the other nodes will receive the pre-prepared message from so every node will receive pre-prepared message from all the other nodes. And if a node will find at least 2f plus 1 number of prepared messages, okay, which are equal to the pre-prepared messages, then they will commit, right? Then they will generate the commit message and will circulate it among themselves, right? So the example will basically clear this algorithm. This algorithm will be clear using this algorithm, right? So here you can see, here is the primary node, and rest of the nodes are secondary nodes, right? And among these secondary nodes, you can see that some of the nodes are faulty, right? So red ones are faulty and the blue ones are honest node, right? Among these blue ones, this node is primary node. So primary node will generate the pre-prepared message and will, sorry, here actually this is the requester. This is not the primary node. These are the nodes. And among these nodes, these red ones are faulty nodes and blue ones are non-faulty node. But this is a user which is requesting, right? So which is requesting to perform a particular task. So this request will be submitted to only the primary node, right? So then after receiving the request, primary node will generate the pre-prepared message, and this pre-prepared message will be circulated to all the other replicated nodes. Here you can see the primary node is broadcasting the pre-prepared message to all the other nodes, right? So all the other nodes will verify the pre-prepared message, and if verification is successful, then they will generate the pre-prepared message, and this pre-prepared message will be circulated among themselves, right? You can see that since this is a honest note, it will verify the message correctly. And after verification, after successful verification, it will correctly generate the prepared message and will circulate the prepared message to all the other guys, right? But since this is dishonest, it will not do anything, right? Similarly, this is a dishonest guy, it will not do anything, right? So after receiving the prepared message, they will check or verify the prepared message for the correctness. And the prepare, if the prepare message is correct, then they will commit, and they will generate the commit message, and commit message will be circulated among themselves, right? And if they will receive at least one number of commit message, then they will forward the decision to the main user, which initially requested for the service, right? So here you can see that a user basically requesting to the primary node. Primary node is generating the prepared message and circulating to every other nodes. Every other nodes is generating, checking the prepared message, and after successful verification, they are generating prepared message and circulating to every other node. Then after verification of the prepared message, they are circulating the commit message, and if they are finding at least 2A+1 number of commit message, they are confirming the user for the decision, right? In this way, the single decision is taken by all the party, okay? Even if they do not have trust among themselves, right? So I can say that they need to have minimum 3A+1 number of replicas where if number of nodes are faulty. So I am not going to the explanation of this because time will not permit me. So I'm skipping this. So I can say that we actually need minimum 3A+1 number of replicas in order to ensure that the algorithm will work properly or correctly, right? So if somebody is interested, I can discuss at the questionnaire session, right? So now question may arise that if the primary is faulty, right? So because a user is requesting directly to the primary node, but that primary node is faulty or malicious, but that primary node may forward some wrong message or will silent, right? So in that case, what will happen, right? So in that case, that will be detected. So the system is such that if the primary is faulty, that will be detected. That means the other replicas will check in a regular fashion whether the primary node is silent for a long time or not. If the primary node is silent for a long time, then they will initiate another view, right? So if you remember, I was telling that there can be multiple views, right? In one view, there are one primary node and rest of the nodes are secondary node. So if primary node is faulty in that view, then the view has to be changed. Okay, so a new view will be created. In that view, another node will be elected to become primary node, right? So in this way, if the primary node is faulty, then still the consensus algorithm will not stop. Consensus algorithm will still be live, right? So you can see that the practical Byzantine fault tolerance algorithm satisfying two property. One is safety property. That means if it basically provides safety if all non-faulty replicas agree on the sequence number of requests that commit locally, right? So that means if all the replicas are agreeing one such value, that value will be same, right? And according to liveness property, even if some nodes are faulty, still the network will keep on working. As you can see that even if the primary node is faulty, still the network will work correctly, right? So this is the correctness of the practical Byzantine fault tolerance algorithm, right? So we have already seen two algorithms. One is Byzantine agreement algorithm, and second one is practical Byzantine fault tolerance algorithm, or in short, it is a PBFT algorithm. Now let us see the third one, which is much popular, and this algorithm is used in popular cryptocurrency, that is Bitcoin or Ethereum. So these are nowadays popular cryptocurrency. So in these cryptocurrencies, this consensus algorithm, this proof of work is used, right? So now let us see this algorithm, right? So before going to discuss this algorithm, let us see the double spending problem in you can say cryptocurrency, right? So as I have already said, that blockchain means there is a chain of blocks. So there is the first block and this is the second block. The second block is containing the hash value of the first block. Third block is containing the hash value of the second block, and so on and on, right? So if somebody wants to tamper in this block, it has to tamper this block and it has to tamper this block as well, right? Otherwise it will not be successful. Okay, why he will not be successful? Because if somebody will only tamper this block, then it will be caught here, because hash value of this block is kept here. Okay, if somebody will tamper this block, of course the hash value will be changed, and that hash value will not match with the hash value which is kept in this block, right? So similarly, if somebody wants to tamper this block, he has to tamper the hash value which is kept here as well, right? So suppose, so according to double spending problem, suppose Alice and Bob is there. Alice wants to buy some material from Bob, right? Bob is the supplier and Alice is the buyer, right? Alice is having suppose say $50, right? Alice is having only $50 in his account, and Alice wants to buy something from Bob, right? So in order to suppose the cost of that item is $50, right? So Alice will pay the entire $50 to Bob. So Alice will have $50 and that will go to Bob, right? Okay, so Alice will pay $50 to Bob, and that transaction will be verified by every node in the blockchain, and that will be verified successfully. Why it will be verified successfully? Because this transaction is correct, right? Why this transaction is correct? Whenever some node will verify the transaction, it will check whether Alice is having $50 in its account or not, right? So in order to check whether $50 is there in its account or not, it will check the previous blocks, right? So it will check previous blocks which are connected through the chain, right? So it will check this block and this block, right? So whenever a node will check whether the $50 is available with Alice, so it will check this block and it will also check this block. So clearly from this block you can see that Alice is having $50 in her account. So Alice is eligible to transfer $50 to Bob, right? So this transaction is valid. So this transaction will be added into the blockchain in this block, right? Through this block, right? But Alice may do some malicious task, right? So Alice can be a malicious. Suppose Alice is not honest. Alice is a malicious guy. So what Alice will do? Alice will create another transaction, say A to ADAS. So ADAS is another account which is held by Alice. So Alice will transfer the same value, $50, to its own account, to another account, right? Another its own account, right? So this block will be created by Alice. Now this block will be circulated among all the parties. Now all the parties will check whether this transaction is correct or not. In order to check the transaction, is correct or not, you can see that since this block is connected to this block, right? So all the honest party will verify this block, right? They will not verify this block, right? So according to their verification, this transaction will correct, because you can see if I an honest party and I see that there is some transaction from Alice A to A dash, I have to verify that Alice is having $50 or not. So I will check this block. So here I can see that Alice is having $50 from this block. I can see the information. So of course I will be convinced that Alice is really have $50 in his account. So he is eligible to transfer that value, right? So this block will be validated, right? So in this way, Alice will be successful to add this block into the blockchain, right? But honest party, so there is some rules such that the honest party will extend the only the longest chain, right? Honest party will not extend the shortest chain, but honest party will extend the longest chain, right? So if there are multiple other honest party, they are supposed to extend the longest chain. Now, if you compare this chain and this chain, which one is longest? This one is longest, right? So since this one is longest, honest party will tend to extend this chain. So honest party will extend this chain, right? So you can see that Bob will be confirmed that this transaction will be confirmed. So Bob will confirm that he has received $50 from Alice. So upon getting confirmation, Bob will deliver the item to Alice at this point of time. Now, after getting delivery, what Alice will do, Alice will generate multiple fraud blocks, right? Multiple other blocks. Maybe these are correct blocks. Maybe transaction in these blocks are correct, but these blocks will be added by Alice in this chain, not in this chain. So if Alice is honest, then it would extend this chain. But here you can see that instead of extending this chain, Alice is extending the shortest chain, right? So at this point you can clearly see that this chain becomes longest or longer than this chain, right? So if at this point of time, if some honest party will add some blocks, it will see that since this chain is longest, it will add the block in this chain instead of this chain, right? So this chain will be discarded by all the honest party, right? So if this chain will be discarded, then you can clearly see that this transaction will be invalidated, right? So among this transaction, you can see the same value is transferred twice, but this transaction will be invalidated later on, and this transaction will become permanent, right? So so you can clearly see that Bob has already delivered item to Alice, but still, although it already delivered the item to Alice, it will not receive the $50 in its own account, right? So this is the double spending attack, which being a malicious person, Alice can perform, right? But yes, the game has not finished yet, right? Let us see the algorithm. So we should have a consensus algorithm which will stop this kind of malicious behavior of Alice, so that some fraud transaction can be prevented, right? So here you can see that double spending is a kind of fraud transaction. So this fraud transaction can be prevented. For that, we need to have a proper consensus algorithm, right? So this chain will be discarded and this chain will return, right? Okay. So we have a proof of work, which is very famous or popular and is used in Bitcoin or Ethereum cryptocurrency, and many other cryptocurrency also use this concept. And there is some other consensus algorithm that is called proof of stake, which is used in PRCoin cryptocurrency, right? So the idea of proof of work is that whenever somebody is proposing a block, he has to not, he has not only to propose a correct block, but also he has to show that he has done some work, right? Okay, so so suppose I am proposing some block, so not only I have to propose a correct block, but also I have to show that I have done some work, right? So the block will be selected based on the resource which is utilized by the person who are proposing the block, right? So the idea is that, so idea here is that suppose there is a proposer, say P, it has one computer, right? It has one computer, single computer it has, right? So it will generate one block and it will perform some work, predefined work, say W, okay? Now it is quite possible that the same proposer can replicate this block and this work, right? It is quite possible. So it can replicate multiple times, right? So if it is on a dishonest node, if it is a dishonest node, it will replicate the same block and the proof of work multiple times, right? So as such, it will look as such, this guy is having four nodes, four computers, but originally this guy is having only one computer, but it will look that there are four computers which is held by this same proposer. But if there is some honest node, he has a single computer and he will generate a blocks, he will generate this block and he will generate the proof of works W, right? So this is proposer P2, which is honest, and this is dishonest, right? Now you can see this proposer will parallelly propose four blocks and this proposer is proposing only one block, right? So among these five blocks, one block will be selected randomly, right? So five blocks will be circulated, and among these five blocks, one block will be selected randomly. Okay, so what is the chance that block of P1 will be selected? The chance is 4/5, right? The probability that one of the block of proposer P1 will be selected is 4/5. And the probability that the block of P2 will be selected is 1/5. So of course, 4/5 is greater than 1/5. So clearly you can see that if there is a dishonest node, it can propose multiple blocks, although it has a small computer, right? Single computer, right? Now, if the work is such that it is a very high computational task, right? If it is a high computational task, then it is quite difficult for this proposer to generate four proof of work, right? So this is work one, this is work two, this is work three, this is work four, right? Well, of course, work one will not be equal to work two will not be equal to work three, work three will not be equal to work four, right? So it is quite difficult using the same computer to solve or to generate the different proof of work using the same computer, right? So if the computation in order to generate the proof of work is very high, and using the same computer, it is quite possible to perform this kind of malicious behavior. Okay, so here you can see that P1 can only generate only one block, okay, and only one proof of work. Similarly, P2 will generate one block and only one proof of work, right? So you can see that this P1 is dishonest, P2 is honest, but still the selection probability of P1 is half and selection probability of P2 is half, right? So here you can see the underlying concept is that every proposer has to solve a difficult problem which requires a huge amount of computation resources, right? So huge amount of computation, if somebody do not have huge amount of computing resources, then he cannot actually replicate, right? So this is the philosophy that select nodes in proportion to computing power. So all the nodes will compete for right to create block, and the problem will be problem which has to be defined that has to be solved will make moderately hard, so that it will be difficult to solve the problem, so that it will be not easy for a malicious node to generate multiple solution at the same time, right? So for that they have to solve the difficult problem that is called hash puzzle, right? In hash puzzle, they have to generate the hash value, right? In the hash value, the input parameters are the transactions, right? Current transactions, then the hash value of the previous block, and they have to use one nonce value, right? So they have to generate such a hash value which the value of that is less than some target value. Okay, if the value is greater than some target value, then that solution will not be accepted, right? So you can see, so this is the output space of the hash value. So you can see, I can divide into multiple blocks. So this is one block. So So it will be 0, 0, 0. If all are zero, and it will be so one, and maybe all are zero, right? All are zero, right? So you can see that if such a value can be generated, which is all the bits in this block is zero, okay? So that value is of course less than the target value, right? So if that kind of value will be generated, if that kind of hash value will be generated, then that will satisfy this condition. So in summary, what we can say that using this input value, that is the hash value of the previous block, the set of transaction, and some random value, they have to generate such a value which should be less than some target value, okay? Which cannot be easily generated, right? In order to generate that value, one has to try all the possible kind of nonce, right? So it will first try nonce N1, nonce N2, nonce N3, and so on and on, right? So all the possible nonce they have to try, and if the guy is lucky, sometime it can generate such a hash value which will be less than this target value, right? So you can clearly see that if somebody is having a high computing resources, then it is highly likely that it can generate that value. But if somebody do not have high computing resources, cannot easily generate this value. Okay, so the property of this hash value is such that, or this problem is such that it will be difficult to compute. The cost is parameterizable cost. That means the nodes can automatically recalculate the target, and they are trivial to verify, right? So these are the three properties of the hash value. So they have to generate the hash value so that these three properties will be satisfied, so that nobody can monopolize, right? Now let us move on how it will solve this double spending problem, right? So here you can see that Alice was malicious, right? And on the honest parties are tend to add or extend their longest chain, but Alice, being a malicious guy, he will extend the shorter chain, so will tend to create a number of block, okay, consecutive blocks it will create. It will try to get successful, right? So Alice will try to get successful by creating a consecutive number of blocks such that this long will become eventually this block, this chain will become longest, so this chain will become obsolete and this chain become correct. But you can see, according to the concept of proof of work, it is very, very difficult for Alice to create a number of consecutive blocks, because Alice may not have more than 50% of the resource of all the resources in the network, right? So there is a network, okay? So total resources, I can say 100%. So suppose it is very unlikely that one person, say Alice, will have more than 50% of resources among all these resources. So Alice will have less than, if the assumption is that Alice will have less than 50% of resources. Since Alice will have less than 50% of resources, Alice may generate some block, okay, but it is not possible that Alice's block will be selected with more than 50% chance. So it is highly unlikely that consecutive blocks of Alice, which is being proposed by Alice, will be selected randomly, more than 50% chance. There is no probability is not more than 50% that Alice's block will be selected all the time, right? So in this way, so according to this principle, there is a very less chance that Alice will get successful, right? So although there is some probability that Alice can perform some double spending attack kind of problem, right? But due to proof of work consensus algorithm, we can clearly see that Alice will not be successful. Even Alice malicious or Byzantine node, Alice will not be successful, right? So we can see that using proof of work algorithm, if somebody wants to perform double spending kind of thing in Bitcoin network, right? So we can see, we know that Bitcoin is a very popular cryptocurrency, and in this network, many people will perform transaction, right? And there may be some malicious guy who will try to perform transaction maliciously. Even if that guy do not have enough amount of Bitcoins, he will try to spend the previous spent, already spent Bitcoin to some other guy, okay? But our proof of work consensus algorithm ensures that it is not possible, right? So as I have said, that in a blockchain, there are multiple nodes, and multiple nodes are distributively coming up with one decision. Here in the case of proof of work, they are accepting only that blocks which have correct transactions. And of course, it is highly unlikely that the honest party can generate a longest chain. In this way, it ensures that only the correct values or correct transaction or correct Bitcoins will be accepted by the Bitcoin network, right? So this is all about the proof of work algorithm. Now let us conclude. So concept of blockchain can be used in many distributed applications. So not only any cryptocurrency, the blockchain can be used or applied in any kind of distributed application where you do not want to depend upon a centralized party or single party. In that case, you can apply blockchain, which basically help you to take one proper or correct decision in a distributed way, right? So most of these applications need proper consensus algorithm. So there is some existing algorithm. For existing algorithm, we have seen that proof of work algorithm, proof of stake is another algorithm. Right, so we have seen PBFT algorithm, we have seen Byzantine algorithm, and similarly there are many more other algorithms which exist in the literature. So depending on your application, you have to check which algorithm is suitable for your application, right? So of course you can find out some suitable algorithm which may be applied, right? So this proof of work is applied in Bitcoin, in Ethereum, and we have already seen that proof of stake is used in PRCoin network, and PBFT algorithm, what we have discussed, that is actually used in Hyperledger Fabric or Hyperledger Sawtooth, right? So there are already existing framework which is available so in the internet. So if someone wants to if someone wants to design a distributed application and wants to perform the experiment, your application, then they can use the existing Ethereum or Bitcoin framework in order to evaluate their application, right? So in order to see which framework is most suitable, they have to check which framework is more suitable for their algorithm or their application. Of course, they have to check which consensus algorithm is most suitable for their algorithm, right? If there is no such suitable consensus algorithm is found, then of course you have to propose your own consensus algorithm, right? So you can use one such consensus algorithm which is already existing, but if there is no such existing algorithm which is applicable for your application, you have to design your own algorithm, right? So these are some selected references. I can go through these references. Many research papers are here. We can go through many research papers, so we can know many other informations regarding consensus algorithm and many other things. So you can go through these references, right? So with this, I stop here. So I would love to answer your questions. So thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your wonderful speech regarding blockchain and cryptocurrency. There are several questions have been posted on the chat box. Now we will start our question answer session. Shall we start, sir?
Yes, of course.
First question was asked by Nasreen Parveen. She has completed her MSc recently. She wants to know about future research topics on blockchain.
Okay, so blockchain, actually, as I have discussed, that blockchain is a distributed network, right? So so blockchain research, one research is that you can design a good consensus algorithm. So this is one line you can try. Another is that you can use blockchain network, right? So suppose you want to design one such distributed application, and you need one such existing consensus algorithm, or So in that case, you can actually use a blockchain network, right? So this is another kind of research direction. So blockchain research in blockchain, this doesn't mean that you have to research on blockchain only, but also you can apply blockchain wherever you want to. Most specifically, it is used in distributed kind of applications, right? Okay.
Next question. Prajna Rai asked, sir, what is the scope of the research work of blockchain IoT integration? If you please suggest the research area of blockchain where we can actually work and feasible also.
Okay. So IoT means Internet of Things, right? So Internet of Things, there are many sensors, many actuators. I mean, the concept of Internet of Things is that all the things which are being used in the system, all the things will be directly connected to the internet, and there will be some collaboration among themselves in order to perform a particular task, right? So for example, there are some sensors which are sensing some data, and based on the sensed data, they want to come to a consensus, right? So of course, there can be some distributed application on that IoT-based system where they have to come to a proper consensus based on the sensed data. So there you can use blockchain, right? So in IoT, if you want to do research on IoT, you can actually use blockchain. Right. So this is so. Of course, there is a scope of using blockchain in IoT related research. Right. Yeah.
Next question: how the different tools of blockchain finance get benefits from different consensus algorithm? Are these helpful to calculate the different hash value generation?
Different hash value generation. Actually, there are two questions. First question is how this blockchain will help in different cryptocurrency. Am I right?
Am I right? Yes. Yeah.
How blockchain will help in cryptocurrency, right?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. That was my question.
Okay. So your answer of your first question is that suppose there is a bank, right, in a existing banking system, there is a centralized system, right? So suppose that you are depending on the centralized system, and that centralized system may be malicious or may be faulty, right? Sometime the server of your bank may be down, right? In that case, you cannot perform your transaction, but although you want to perform the transaction at that particular time, it is very much important to perform your transaction, but your server is down, right? So this happened. Why? Because there is a centralized system. Okay. And also it is quite possible that the centralized system may be malicious, right? Suppose you have 1 lakh or 1 crore rupees in your account, but bank is saying that no, you do not have 1 crore account, or say 1 lakh account money in your account, right? Okay, so originally you should have 1 lakh money in your account, but bank is denying that you have 1 lakh rupees in your account, right? So it is quite possible. So of course there will be some proof, but in a centralized system it is highly possible that your proof can be denied. And maybe sometime bank can be collapsed, right? So recently some bank has got collapsed, right? I mean, so all the money which is kept in the bank, that all went, right? So if it is a distributed system, then there is no possibility of this kind of things, right? Okay. So since there is not a centralized party, if one party will be failure, then there are many other parties are there who will ensure your service, right? So at any point of time, your transaction will not be failure, right? Even if some party or some nodes or some nodes are faulty, right? So in this way, if you are using blockchain in managing the money in the bank, right, then the money of all the customers will be saved. I mean, will be saved, right? The bank also can deny it because according to the consensus algorithm, most of the nodes in the network are honest. So the ultimate decision that you are claiming that you have 1 lakh rupees in your account, but some party may deny that you have 1 lakh rupees in your account, but there are maximum party who are honest, they will not deny, right? So consensus will be achieved based on the input from the honest party, as we have seen, right? So if you have really 1 lakh rupees in your account, nobody can deny the 1 lakh rupees in your account, right? So in this way, blockchain actually help in cryptocurrency, right? And can you remember the second question?
Are these helpful to calculate the different hash value generation?
Yeah, so actually it will not helpful to different to generate different hash value. So basically it is using hash value, right? So in blockchain it is using hash value, so there is some algorithm using which you have to calculate the hash value. So hash value is such a value, it is a hash function, is a such a function, so that you have one input, and based on that input some hash value will be generated. But using that hash value, you cannot claim there are two such input, right? So for one hash value there will be no multiple inputs, right? So it is a kind of one way function, right? It is a kind of one way function. Okay. So there is some function using which you can actually generate the hash value. Okay, so here we have a single block, we have a first block using some hash, some function, say hash function. If I input the block as the input of that function, it will generate some hash value, right? So there is some hash function, say SHA1, SHA256, SHA506. Those are called secure hash algorithm, right? So those are used in blockchain technology, but of course using blockchain you cannot generate any hash value, right? Okay, next question.
Last question asked by Rudrajit Dutta Roy. Can these algorithms be implemented in an artificial intelligence?
Blockchain, right? Blockchain can be used in artificial intelligence. Yes, of course. Depending on your application, suppose you in artificial intelligence, you just come up with some decision, right? You want to take some decision, right? So you want to take decision artificially, right? So suppose there are multiple nodes which are taking decision artificially, right? Suppose you are running one machine learning algorithm, and using machine learning algorithm you want to take decision, but you want to take the decision so you have a distributed system, and in a distributed system you have a multiple nodes, and every nodes are running machine learning algorithm, right? So whatever machine learning algorithm is taking decision by every other node, right? So ultimately the decision should be same, right? So if you are using artificial intelligence in distributed system, then also you can use this blockchain concept, okay, where you can come up with one correct decision. Because you see that if you see machine learning or artificial intelligence, artificial intelligence basically predicts some value, right? It is quite possible that all the machine will not predict the same value, but majority should predict the same value. so that that predicted value will be decided. So your application is such that the predicted value is agreed upon by majority of the of all the nodes. In that kind of artificial intelligence application, you can use blockchain, right? Ultimately, the thing is that the say, thing will be same, that if there are multiple party, you have to come to a consensus. So if you have to come to a consensus, if there are multiple party who need to collaboratively take some decision, then you have to use blockchain. You can use, basically you can use blockchain in that case. Okay.
Thank you, sir, for answering all the questions. Now, I would like to request our HOD, Sandipan Basu, to continue the session.
Thank you, Anupamda. Now, I would request our principal, sir, to conclude this event. Sir, please.
Thank you, Sandipan. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Shubhashish Dhal of IIT Guwahati, for explaining this unknown world to us. Though we are now familiar with these terms, Bitcoin, Litecoin, Ripple, Ether, etc., basically a digital asset, blockchain cryptocurrency is designed to work as a medium of exchange. Unlike physical currencies, blockchain cryptocurrency works on digital channels and are often adhered to strong cryptography to secure financial transactions that happen online. I once again thank Dr. Dhal for his illuminating lecture. Thank you, sir. Thanks to Computer Science Department for organizing this webinar, to their head Sandipan and teachers Anupam and Shomit for arranging such a webinar. Thanks to all who participated in this webinar. And I think this type of webinar will help our students to understand the new developments which are going on in and around us. Thank you very much.
Okay. I also would like to thank Sandeep and Dr. Chakraborty for inviting me in this talk or webinar. So, yeah. I would be happy if there is any other talk, so that I'd be happy to attend those as well. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable time and your enlightening talk that helps us to go through the different aspects of blockchain and cryptocurrency. I am sure the participants have enjoyed the session. And I would request all the participants to fill the feedback form. Please be careful with the spellings, because the details will be printed on the e-certificates. So have a look before submitting the form. So thank you once again for your interest and for your participation. Hope we'll see all of you soon. Thank you, Dr. Shubhashish Dhal. Hope we can avail you once again soon. Thank you, everyone.